guys are getting. It's unsurpassed what you're getting, really, truly. When you show up to your rotations, you will be so much more well-versed than any medical school counterparts that are in residencies. I mean that. I know that I would show up and they would expect me to do what a resident would do, and I could. So what you're learning about diabetes is just, it's beyond what most programs of any kind are getting, honestly. I'm really envious of it. That's such a fun disease to treat, I think, because it's so individual. It's not formulaic at all, whereas some things are a bit formulaic. You know, you have a 10 milligram or a 20 milligram or 40 milligram thing. But you have so many drugs you can use. And then you just really get to teach so much, because chronic illness becomes an opportunity for you to really enter into a relationship with the patient where you can make a difference. You know, you can throw drugs at them, but you can really make a difference. And him talking about addressing this depression component that I think is just, it's just so fascinating. They're just so good. So I ask you what one of my first counselors, I've had horrible depression and anxiety in my life, suicidal depression, I will admit. And one of my first counselors said, "What are you doing to nurture yourself?" And I was like, "I live alone. Everything I do is for me. You know, I mean, I'm not cleaning up after anybody or cooking for anybody or anything." And so, you know, I ask myself that a lot, because it really goes to creating that connection to yourself where you can think clearly. You know, I don't know if that makes any sense to you, but it certainly does to me. But, you know, what are you doing to nurture yourself? And that's different for everybody, but just make sure you're asking yourself that question and then you're answering that question. You know, I think that's a good thing to do to maintain your health, because you cannot show up as an authentic provider of health care if you're all effed up. So anyway, the endocrine system. So it's a little bit of a backtrack, because you did already have a lot of endocrine system, and you certainly have. Wow, we brought a 3-hole punch, man. Right on. I have one everywhere. Tucked in my bra right now. It's very discreet. A glue stick and a 3-hole punch. So you've already had a good bit of introduction to this, and I say it again, I keep trying to sell you on the rest of the year, is that this redundancy becomes very important, because your bitterness goes up. So it also helps that the repetition goes up as well. So here they are, and this is a hormone. The endocrine system will be secreting hormones, and a hormone is a messenger that's released from one site and has its effect on a distant target site, typically carried by circulatory and or lymph systems. Sort of circulation, and it can have a very localized effect as well. But you combine neural regulation with hormonal control, and we get everything done that we need to do, because you have all these disparate systems that have to be controlled in a homogeneous, obviously, organ system sort of way, organism sort of way, and that's what the endocrine system does, along with the nervous system. So you got your glands, endocrine glands, generally ductless. So you're not using a duct to squirt stuff out. They're just, the cells are releasing information, and there will be a capillary bed really surrounding these glands, taking up that that hormone into lymph and or into blood. So your basic glands, your pituitary, thyroid, parathyroid, adrenals, the pineal gland, which you really don't talk about here, but that's circadian sort of cycles. Thymus, which is a gland that is going to be important in immune function and decreases over life. So we'll be talking about those first ones. And organ systems you've already covered with endocrine tissue function, gonads, gonads, pancreas. I think you heard about a little bit about pancreas last week. When is that? Do you have an exam that's just specific for diabetes?
Yes.
On Friday, and then you'll have the rest of the endocrine system.
Not that one.
And then, so you've heard a bit about pancreas, kidneys, heart, also within the function, hormone types. There are two, three flavors that they come in, steroid-flavored hormones, peptide protein hormones, and amine hormones. As steroids come from cholesterol, so mentioned this along the way, talking about, you know, estrogen, testosterone, produced by gonads, placenta, adrenal glands. So we'll talk about those later. They cross cell membranes and bind to intracellular receptors, which is just interesting. Peptide protein hormones, you probably can name one for sure, which you've been talking about, yeah, insulin. Usually bind to target cell surface receptor. I think you probably discussed the insulin receptor. Oh, so what's the thing about Dr. McNeil's lecture? Is it like from the Cayman Islands or something? Mm-hmm. Do you think he'll be having a pina colada? Do you think he drinks something like, he probably drinks something with an umbrella and a big piece of fruit and a bunch of things. I mean, it's probably pink or something. But, you know, you can talk awful about them for being there right now. And then amines are synthesized from tyrosine, and that's going to be the catecholamines, epinephrine, norepinephrine, dopamine, also binding to an intracellular receptor. So that's just interesting. If you have a cell surface receptor, you're generally using a second messenger system, like utilizing cyclic AMP, diacylglycerol, that sort of thing. And if it's an intracellular receptor, you're functioning right at the level of transcription for that control. So that's cute and different. So, bit about hormone synthesis, peptide hormones produced by protein synthesis, like all proteins, peptides are synthesized as pre-pro hormones, cleaved in the endoplasmic reticulum during their processing to the prohormone, placed in secretory vesicles, often activated inside there, or just upon secretion. And exocytosis will release granules of hormone when stimulated by a specific signal. And so the secretory pathway is often where you're regulating that, so the protein synthesis is producing the hormone for storage, and it's regulated upon release. It's kind of overall typically how that would happen. For steroid hormones, you're synthesizing from the cholesterol itself. And so you regulate those. They may be constitutively made, but the regulation is usually in some sort of enzymatic process along the way, along that production pathway. How are they transported? Peptides, amines, proteins can be free in circulation, but steroids are insoluble because, you know, like fats are. And so often will be bound to a carrier. And so you have the liver is making a lot of those steroid binding proteins. There'll be a variety of names for the different flavor of hormone they may be carrying. And then they're able to, they have to be, that cholesterol hormone has to be removed from its carrier and then enters the cell for that intracellular receptor. And that can happen in a variety of ways. Sometimes they're endocytosed, and in the lysosomal granules, you'll have cleavage from that protein carrier molecule. But when you do this, then you have a store of hormones as well. So sometimes the steroid hormones, sometimes they're going to have a little bit longer half-life. In a sense, there's more reservoir because of that property of the lipid nature, and kind of overall, not necessarily a complete truth for that. But steroid hormones tend to be a little more long-lasting, especially like the estrogens and testosterone. The target cell, so you're spewing from a gland. I thought that was a little funny. I don't know why. So your glands are spewing hormones. And so really hormones are then circulated. See, it's super funny. God. Sorry. You're a nerd. My name we'll meet later. We'll talk about erasers. Okay. Pens. All right, I didn't say that loud. So you're kind of soaking all cells in this hormone, but only those cells with receptor to that hormone will then, of course, be the target of its effect. And so those are target cells because they have the specific receptor either on the cell surface or intercept. And so how that depends, the receptor hormone binding is certainly going to depend on things like amount of hormone availability, receptor availability, number of receptors present. Sometimes you have some process prior that would prime that tissue for receptors. For example, estrogen and progesterone prime mammary tissue. And one of the things that they can do is upregulate receptors for prolactin and oxytocin. So that's something. Primed tissue will have an increased number of receptors. Excuse me. You also have an affinity for the hormone. A half-life of the hormone. All of these things that you think about, really, mostly, with how, bioavailability for drugs and the elimination of drugs and stuff like that. It's kind of like that for hormones, too. What's the availability and the ability for that cell to receive it? So that's part of that whole interaction. Mechanism of action. So when a hormone binds its receptor, what are some of the things that happen on the cell? We would like to affect a response in the target cell, and it's going to be upregulation or inhibition of some sort of activity. Quite often it's upregulation. And some things can be like change in membrane permeability or the potential that protein synthesis of a regulatory molecule or deactivation of protein synthesis. Enzyme activation, deactivation, induction of secretion, stimulation of mitosis or cell division. And some of those things are done through second messengers. So I feel like you keep seeing cyclic AMP in the second messenger system here and there a bit. And we just kind of keep seeing it. Cyclic AMP is made from ATP, and so adenylate cyclase is the enzyme that does that, and you can affect that then as a second messenger. And one of the things with cyclic AMP is it's a G protein coupled receptor, where the receptor for the hormone is coupled to this G protein that binds GTP. Let me close this one. Gosh, this room is cold now. It seems like we were hot here for a while. My late life is coming on. I wear sunscreen, but I realize I've got a lot of color now. I just want to put that out there. I wear sunscreen. I put on 30, and then I put on 70, and then I put 30 on top of that, and then I go back with more 30, and then I go back with more 70, and because I love the sun, I love it. So, the hormone receptor is G-protein-coupled receptor. It'll bind GTP. You'll have dissociation of subunits from that G-protein, which will then activate or inhibit adenylate cyclase. So, quite often you'll have increased cyclic AMP in the cell as a result of that. Sometimes you have decreased cyclic AMP as a result of that, and that will start a series of things. Cyclic AMP can activate protein kinases. A protein kinase is simply a generic name for an enzyme which will phosphorylate a protein. And so there will be a variety of flavors of protein kinases because they will have specific substrates. And so when you phosphorylate a protein, sometimes you turn it off, sometimes you turn it on, just depending on that coupling of that protein kinase with that particular protein. So this second messenger is the cyclic AMP that will then instigate the activity of protein kinase, any specific protein kinase. Cyclic AMP then, if it's increased in the cell, will be eliminated by phosphodiesterase. And so you have drug activities here and there that come at some of these second messengers. So if it's a protein hormone or peptide hormone with a cell surface receptor, the mechanism of action will often be a second messenger system. So it's a cascade effect of that hormone reception at that cell level. You have to dig that drill that response down into the cell, and you're able to do it by sending messengers from the cell membrane surface out into the cytosol. Another example of a second messenger, oh, here's a picture. And in one of these sides, it's showing cyclic AMP inhibiting, or the GTP protein inhibiting cyclic adenylate cyclase, and in some cases, activating or upregulating that activity. So that's just, it's going to be dependent on a particular enzyme. Now, I'm not too hot and bothered that when I said enzyme, I meant hormone. I'm not too hot and bothered that you know which hormone uses specifically which second messenger. I don't think that's important, but this is an introductory thing to just put that all together to remind you that this is how these things work. So that's a picture. Another kind of second messenger system that can be used by peptide or amine hormones, the peptide or protein hormones, is a G protein coupled receptor when G protein subunits via activation of that binding of the hormone will then split phosphatidyl inositol, which is part of the membrane, PIP2. Will split to two things, diacylglycerol, that's DAG, or inositol triphosphate, P3. So like that cyclic AMP is a second messenger here, DAG and IP3 become second messengers. And look what DAG does, diacylglycerol also functions through protein kinase activation to create phosphorylation of proteins and turning them on or off to create a secondary response. And you have IP3 as a result of the split of that PIP to increase intracellular calcium. And that is going to, intracellular calcium will then create a lot of things. And one thing that intracellular calcium is often really responsible for is increasing exocytosis of those cytoplasmic granules, or those vesicles which would be holding or protein, so it can increase secretory function in a lot of cases. But also calcium, more enzymatic activation. So just one of the two, everything, it doesn't switch off. One hormone uses a certain thing, a certain second messenger, if there's no switch. But those are kind of the biggies in terms of second messenger systems. And then there's a picture. Steroid hormones will bind to intracellular receptors. That intracellular receptor can be in the cytoplasm, can be in the nucleus itself. Quite often it's in the nucleus. And so that steroid or lipid nature protein will be bound, or lipid nature hormone will bind to this intracellular receptor. That forms a dimer, and it makes some sort of change in transcription, and it could be on or off. Sometimes those intracellular receptors sit on DNA themselves, and its binding of that removes them, causes conformational change, and they no longer are sticky to the DNA or to that promotion, transcription promotion region. And they fall away, and then protein synthesis will ensue. So you can have upregulation of transcription, therefore more protein product. So, different nature of the molecule creates a different response on the target cell. Feedback control, just a basic definition here to remind you that you have to control your glands. That would make a lovely pillow, control your glands. Oh, what a lovely, we should just have for every 16-year-old, I should just be needle pointing, control your glands. Happy birthday. Anyway, so often you have a negative feedback. The system that promotes the hormone to create this response in a cell, so that secretion will feedback and negatively influence the release of that hormone. And that's generally the case. And that makes sense. That creates just a nice balance. We don't have a lot of positive feedback examples, but one is oxytocin, where it amps up more and more. So So more oxytocin will enhance the release of more oxytocin. That's a positive and less common feedback mechanism. Control your glands. I should, aw, is this your boyfriend? Nice. Control your glands. I'm going to work that into a lot of adult life scenarios. Fun for everybody. The hypothalamus, the first thing, you're terrified. Would you wish I would be your in-law? What's worse? What would be terrible, having me as an in-law or having me as a mother? No, no, such a mixed bag of blessings. I have slideshows for everything. If I could only do the STDs for you guys. Hypothalamus, homeostatic center for chemistry and temperature of internal environment, acting with the limbic system, controlling the body and emotions. It's just all very, it's just all very neural and psychic. And so the hypothalamus will be largely directing the pituitary gland, which will then be largely directing the rest of the glands. So that's where we start. To remind you, hypothalamus. So you have that corpus callosum or that interconnection network between the hemispheres, and then a nice big ventricle there. The thalamus kind of in that region, so when in doubt, thalamus, because it's a relay station for stuff coming up, ascending, and then diverting to higher levels, and then descending relay tracks down as well. The hypothalamus exists just below that, so see hypothalamus sitting inferior to the thalamus and just above the pituitary gland. You have a couple of different tracks. So here is the hypothalamus. You see the optic chiasm right there and the pituitary gland, so we can't talk about one without the other. So there is an anterior pituitary lobe and a posterior pituitary lobe, and the hypothalamus is connected to each of them in different ways, to each of those lobes, because the hypothalamus will be directly affecting the release of hormones from the pituitary gland. So the hypothalamic hypophyseal tract is the connection between the hypothalamus and the posterior lobe. And the posterior lobe of the pituitary gland arose as an outpocketing from the neural tissue itself. It arose from the hypothalamus. So the neurons that begin in the hypothalamus really extend through the infundibulum to the posterior pituitary gland itself. So that infundibulum is the stalk. And then there's going to be a big, large capillary plexuses around that thing to receive hormones. So really, for the posterior pituitary gland, there is a neural tract or extension of the hypothalamus to there. So posterior pituitary hormones are really made by the hypothalamus, sent along to the posterior gland for release. Two hormones. There are a couple of nuclei within the hypothalamus that will direct the production and the synthesis and the transport to the posterior pituitary. The supraoptic nuclei will be producing ADH. So we've talked about ADH in the kidney section and also in probably the cardiovascular system as well. But now that's all already blurred. Me, I can't imagine how it is for you guys. But that's coming from the hypothalamus. Paraventricular nuclei are producing oxytocin. So we can't separate these two things. And it's the hypothalamic hypophyseal tract is that actual neural connection between the hypothalamus and the posterior pituitary. And then here's that same picture, but bigger. And so posterior pituitary, you really just see these supraoptic and paraventricular nuclei, just the fibers just going directly to the posterior pituitary gland. It's different for the other side between the hypothalamus and the anterior pituitary. There is a portal system, and so the other time you see the word portal system is hepatic portal system. That's a just meaning really a kind of direct connection from one place to the other, kind of bypassing the larger circulation in the sense that you have a direct line. And so between the small intestine and the liver, you have a portal system. Here is a direct connection from the hypothalamus to the anterior pituitary, so the hypophyseal portal system. And in this case, the anterior pituitary gland arose as an outpocketing of the oral mucosa, which is just so interesting. And it was called the Reinke's pocket. And so it just disconnected, lost its connection to the oral mucosa and attached to the posterior lobe of the pituitary. So they really are different tissues and therefore function in a different way. So the hypothalamus never had a connection to it and has to use a portal tract or a little venule sort of system, circulatory system. So neurons of the ventral hypothalamus release hypophysiotropic or releasing hormones. So the hypothalamus in this case will release a hormone that will be sent directly to the anterior pituitary with its action locally to tell the anterior pituitary to release hormones, or to release its hormones into the surrounding capillary bed. And then here, this picture is turned the opposite, looking at from the opposite side. So the anterior pituitary is, just be aware when you're looking at the picture, which way is the anterior. And you see the portal system there, no particular connection. Hypophysiotropic hormones from the hypothalamus are, there's a list, we've talked about a bit of them. There is the corticotropic releasing hormone, or CRH, for obvious reasons, we've reduced these to letters. It's going to stimulate the release of ACTH from the anterior pituitary. And then that's going to go off and affect the adrenal gland, and we'll get to that. There is thyrotropin releasing hormone, TRH, which will affect the anterior pituitary to release TSH, which is a real big one. You're gonna order a lot of TSHs in your career, because we look at thyroid this way. It's a great place to see where the function is or dysfunction is, and it will direct the thyroid. Growth hormone releasing hormone, GRH, tells the anterior pituitary to release growth hormone. So these are well named, fortunately. Growth hormone inhibiting hormone, also known as somatostatin, or GIH, will inhibit growth hormone release because that's important. And so this is really just a laundry list of names and the function of those that become important when we go directly to the pituitary gland. Gonadotropin releasing hormone, GnRH, to release the stimulate the release of gonadotropins FSH and LH. Your faves, you loved those. It has the effect on the gonads. It gets them to have a work. Prolactin releasing hormone, PRH, stimulates prolactin release from the anterior pituitary, and we can decrease or inhibit the release of prolactin by prolactin inhibiting hormone. So that's just a laundry list. Here's a cute little picture that just shows you, hypothalamus is sending a releasing hormone to the anterior pituitary, which releases a tropic hormone, which will go to a gland and tell it what to do. Here's just another little picture showing me this hypophysiotropic list, some of the babies, TRH, CRH, GnRH, and the effect on the anterior pituitary and then which gland that goes to. So just another little picture. So hypothalamus will release hormones to the anterior pituitary, which will then release hormones that go on to endocrine tissue. The hypothalamus just sends an electrical signal for the release of hypothalamic-produced hormones for the posterior pituitary, and they're only the two, ADH and oxytocin. But let's go to the pituitary gland. So there it is. My husband's a neurosurgeon, and I just remember being super, just so fascinated by the fact that he would operate on, he does brain tumors, and that he would operate on pituitary glands transsphenoidally. I mean, that's just fascinating to me. But you think about that optic chiasm, so those optic nerves are going and crossing in a cruciate sort of form right there in front of the pituitary gland. And so that pituitary gland is just back behind your eyes, basically. Very deep, how else could you get there? And they can just break through the sphenoid and go that way. And so then you worry about, then the dura has to heal, and so people will leak. CSF from their nose until that heals. That just blows me away. I don't know why. But that just is so, wow, that's so cool. You can get to your brain through your nose. Which makes bad smells make way more sense. But, you know, your olfactory gland is like just directly into the sinuses. It's just right there. So anyway, that's cool. So I like that picture. It really reminds you of where that is. It's really small. And so the stuff you'll study in terms of disease for pituitary gland tumors, I think, is just so fascinating. That it's such a, you know, when you see hormones working well, it's just, we don't think so much about it. But then when you have this, people are in a storm of trouble when there are endocrine dysfunctions. So, look what we call this. Hypophysis is the name of the pituitary gland. So you have the neurohypophysis, which would be the posterior pituitary gland, because it's neural in nature. It arose from the hypothalamus, and it really is just axons from nuclei in the hypothalamus that terminate in the posterior pituitary. So it's called the neurohypophysis. And the adenohypophysis, adeno would refer to secretion, really, in a sense. So it's the one that's really secreting, producing and secreting tropic hormones. And it sits there in the, do you remember the name of that bony? Elatersica. That's a good one. So just those are good names. So first, let's look at the anterior pituitary or adenohypophysis. Couple of cell types, the baby, the secretory cells. A secretory cell of the anterior pituitary will end in the word trope. Those are producing tropic hormones. So they're granulated. Those granules are representing the artifacts of dying, where you just see the vesicles with loads of hormone and it will uptake dye more heavily, and so they look grainy microscopically. So that's what granulated means. It just means that any cell that's granulated will release something, in this case hormones. And then folliculostellate cells, and we just have seen this over and over and over again, that you have some sort of satellite or stellate kind of cell that will support the function of the business cell for that tissue. And that's what you have there in the anterior pituitary. And so here are some flavors of secretory cells: somatotrope, lactotrope, corticotrope, thyrotrope, gonadotrope, all well named. Trope, producing tropic hormones that will go to a specific target tissue. Somatotrope, the word soma, referring to body. So you would guess that somatotropes meant growth hormone, probably. Something that will affect the entire body, not just a gonad, not just an endocrine. But affect most cells, so most cells should have growth hormone receptors on them. Somatotropes are the anterior pituitary secretory cells that will release growth hormone. And they're releasing growth hormone under the stimulus of growth hormone releasing hormone from the hypothalamus. For percentage of secretory cells, about half, are going to be growth hormone oriented. So growth hormone is super important in establishing growth and development, but also maintenance throughout life, or reduced value, reduced amount overall. But a big portion of that is dedicated to somatotropes. Lactotropes are making prolactin, and the amount of those will be gender-related. Corticotropes, releasing adrenocorticotropic hormone, which is going to the adrenal gland, about 10%. Thyrotropes, TSH. And really, you can measure any of these, but the one you'll be ordering the most is TSH. That's just one of those things to know. 5% of the cells are doing that. And I think it, I'll just leave that off. Gonadotropes are making FSH, LH, about 20% of those cells. So let's look at these various things. And I wish I didn't have the word melanin there because I think it's a little misleading, but I'll get you there. There is this compound, POMC, pro-opio-melanocortin, and it is a molecule that will be cleaved into a variety of molecules. It's located in anterior pituitary cells, and pro-opio-melanocortin, or PMOC, will be cleaved into a variety of things in the pituitary gland, and look, ACTH is one of them. But I point this out here because it's kind of interesting. Because we don't hardly ever really get to the point that we introduce or talk very much about endorphins because, you know, it's not particularly medical, I guess. We don't necessarily have, which is interesting because it really is. I mean, I guess maybe you talk about it more in pain management and stuff like that, opioid receptors and such. But this is where this comes from. I mean, this is one of the sites this comes from. So the fact that these things are kind of coordinated together, ACTH, lipotropins, endorphins, and then some fragments, which can then, in other tissues, these things can be cleaved into a variety of other things. So in other tissues, this alpha MSH, it's melanin-stimulating hormone or melanin synthesis hormone, can stimulate melanin synthesis. So look at that little line, and then you see it again over there from the fragment. So just follow that little line on ACTH, and you ultimately, you don't produce melanin from PMOC, which is why I wish I didn't have that word there. But it can be result, and fragments of the PMOC will result in melanin production. So when you're looking at these diseases and you see hyperpigmentation along the way, that's kind of where that is coming from, melanin synthesis. So something about melanin and diurnal, you know, light, exposure to light, these kind of things, that goes together in a sense, which is really interesting. From the pituitary gland, brain stimulus, other sites, and you see that it starts with this PMOC and it's somehow related to ACTH, which goes to cortisol manufacture. So then you start to think about these sort of diurnal cycles. So there's that connection that we really in PA school don't ever get to the point that we spend very much time talking about that. But anyway, that's where that comes from. So looking at ACTH from the anterior pituitary manufactured from pro-opio-melanocortin, POMC, it's released by corticotropes, or secretory cells of the anterior pituitary in response to hypothalamic corticotropin-releasing hormone. And the target is the adrenal cortex. Well, does that, the adrenal gland has a medulla and a cortex, so finally that name makes sense. ACTH, adrenocorticotropic hormone. So it's tropic, or has a tropism for the adrenal cortex. Oh, cute. Now you don't have to remember that. It's in the name. Adrenal cortex is the target. Cute. Every now and then they get it right, right? The action is to stimulate the release of glucocorticoids. Those are corticoid or steroid in nature. And so anytime something's a steroid, cholesterol-derived hormone, there will be little tweaks that make them non-identical, or there will be isoforms of that glucocorticoid. So we say the word glucocorticoid, but the most active glucocorticoid is cortisol. So just always put those two words together, because you'll see them both ways. Cortisol from the adrenal cortex, and cortisol, we'll get to all this, but what cortisol is going to try to do is elevate blood sugar. Cortisol is antagonistic to the effects of insulin. Cortisol is this thing that when you wake up of a morning, you should have blood sugar elevated enough to start the day. Cortisol release in a diurnal way gets that ready. And so ACTH has to be pulsed from the anterior pituitary to allow that to happen. And it's inhibited by negative feedback of cortisol itself. So I think this is one of these points that could be a stumbling block for you, just because several things mean one thing. So however that is, tell yourself to shut up and just learn, or whatever you do that works for you. Maybe you're kinder to yourself. That might be a thought. Do that. Oh, that goes back to nurturing yourself, yeah? Okay, see, try that. So ACTH affects release from the anterior pituitary, affects the adrenal cortex to release cortisol. And then there's just some overall kind of quickie function, because we're going to get to that. Another anterior pituitary hormone. Oh, these are just so exciting, list after list, isn't it? I know. Growth hormone produced by somatotropes of the anterior pituitary. There are several genes. There's not just particularly one growth hormone. There's a little varietal. There are varietals bound to an extracellular growth hormone receptor, which is just cute, even though it is a protein hormone. It only has to reach all cells, and maybe that's why this particular adaptation is there. Why is it produced? Because the hypothalamus produced growth hormone, releasing hormone. It was sent along the hypothalamic hypophyseal portal system, and the anterior pituitary stimulated release growth hormone. Actions of growth hormone stimulate growth. It's anabolistic. So uptake of amino acids, production of proteins, uptake of sulfur and cartilage to create cartilage matrix. Lipolysis is the breakdown of lipids, breakdown of fatty acids to release acyls or ketones into the blood, which then are used as a fuel source, especially by muscle. So this is about fuel source and growth. Fuel source for growth. Decrease cellular glucose uptake to maintain blood sugar levels. That's cute. So actually probably producing or promoting fat uptake. Increases somatomedin or IGL production. So I feel that you talked about these insulin-like growth factors last week. But these are growth, this is sort of indirect growth factor. Because growth hormone will stimulate the liver to make insulin-like growth hormone, or IGLs, which will have an anabolic effect on muscle and bone. So growth hormone indirectly does that via these growth hormone-like, or insulin-like growth hormones, or somatomedins. Here is a summary picture here's the little anterior pituitary making growth hormone, and then all of these effects on various tissues, but overall promoting anabolism. And I always like a little picture like that as a summary, and that might be more helpful when you're studying later. Growth hormone is inhibited by somatostatin, which comes from the hypothalamus itself. Also growth hormone with feedback, the somatomedins feedback, and also cortisol as well. So there has to be this coordination really of cortisol and growth hormone to promote growth and maintenance of tissue. And you see these diurnal or daily sort of the bursts. And this is just a very long list of stuff you don't have to agree, but I do think it's kind of interesting, like, okay, so growth hormone, we think of that, we certainly think of, you know, acromegaly, or when growth hormone is in excess and somebody grows sort of beyond what is a set limit. But the, you know, we maintain growth hormone and it's used throughout life. And so what are some of the things that can cause that to be released? And look, exercise. So repair of tissue, not just growth, but maintenance and repair of tissue throughout life. I think that's important to remember. Pyrogen, so fever. And you think about repair systems being important with growth hormone. And we just never think about that again, I think. When you think about health and illness and disease, but really this anterior pituitary growth hormone is helping to maintenance health. Things that decrease the secretion, sleep, glucose, cortisol. So it's an interesting little balance there. And I just put that there for you to remember that this isn't just something that is functioning during adolescence. Thyroid-stimulating hormone, TSH, released by thyrotropes of the anterior pituitary in response to hypothalamic thyrotropin-releasing hormone. It stimulates follicle cells of the thyroid gland to support all portions of thyroid hormone production, manufacture, storage, and release, which we'll get to in a bit. Thyroid's great. You're going to order a lot of TSHs, and you're going to maintenance a lot of people's thyroid hormone over time. In any practice, so many people are going to come to you on medication. So, you know, you think, oh, I just want to do this, but your patients are going to come in with all these medications on board. And having an understanding of how this works obviously makes sense. Another thing, all portions of thyroid hormone manufacture, and that would include iodine uptake as well. It's inhibited by somatostatin and circulating thyroxine, or T4 hormone. We'll talk about that in a bit. But here's just another little picture of how that works. So TSH from anterior pituitary. And another picture with thyroid hormone there, putting all the function together. We'll talk about that in a bit. Gonadotropins, remember gonads? I'm 12, and I'm a boy. I'm a 12-year-old boy. No, I don't think any insult by that. But I just think the word gonad is endlessly funny, like sphincter. So there's that. Do you not? Do you kind of want to snicker a little bit? Or are you more mature than me? Oh, that's good. I'm glad. Good call on selecting you guys, the students. Released by the gonadotropes in response to GnRH, FSH, LH. Go Nads. Russell, can you tell me that someone had a team? Were they the Nads?
Yeah.
And they had the little t-shirts sitting there.
My friend's dad does screen prints for shirts, and there was like a baseball team that was called
Nads.
Go Nads.
Go Nads. I didn't know, but you just show up and just be like, estrogen in the female, testosterone inhibited in the male. Okay. have those. There's a little summary. There's that same little picture from hypothalamus again here for the pituitary to kind of make easy that connection. And with her, let's just take a little potty break for like 5 minutes. And